I am Brother Stephen Elabo, welcoming you to Deeper Life Bible Church, Charlottesville, United States, a place where the undiluted Word of God is being preached. You are about to listen to our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, as he comes forth to share the mind of God with you and your family. I want you to be ready. Pick up your pen and your paper and jot down important messages as they will do you good. God bless you and remain blessed.
In Jesus' name we pray. We're coming to Ezekiel chapter 36. And I'm reading from verse 11. Ezekiel chapter 36. We're reading from verse 11. And I will multiply upon you man and beast, and they shall increase and bring fruit. And I will settle you after your old estate. I will do better. I will do better. I will do better unto you than at your beginnings. And ye shall know that I am the Lord. Then we have the promise of the Lord. And there we have a prophecy of what God says he wants to do, is going to do. He has the power to fulfill his promise. He has the power to do whatever he wants to do. But then there is something that leads to that. There is something that leads to the blessings of God in your life, in my life, in our lives as a church corporately together. Look at verse 25. It says in verse 25, then will I sprinkle clean water upon you. He cannot fully bless us. He cannot richly bless us in the state of dirt, of defilement, of sinning, of iniquity. And therefore he says, yes, I'm going to do better things unto you. And I'm going to multiply you. And I'm going to fulfill all the good desires of your heart. But then it says, I will sprinkle clean water upon you. And ye shall be clean. And from all your filthiness and all your idols will I cleanse you. The salvation. Salvation comes with conversion. Conversion comes with cleansing. It comes with washing. That all the sins of the past, not just of last year, of your whole life, if you have not been born again, if you profess to be born again, but you are not living a righteous life, a clean life, a converted life, a transformed life, it says this is the first thing I'm going to do for you in preparation for the better things I want to fulfill in your life. It says he cleanses. It says he washes. It says he beautifies the life and makes the life clean and righteous and holy. And then he goes to number two in verse 26. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. There are preachers and there are proclaimers of the gospel that think that salvation is all we need. They say, once you are born again, that's all. Once you're saved, that's all. And when you talk about another experience, the work of grace, a second work of grace in your heart and your life, they say, what's that? They say, we got everything in verse 25. We got everything in salvation. We got everything in that initial experience of being born again. Why did God then promise another thing? Because he said in verse 25, I'm going to sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean. That is done in verse 25. And there is no doubt about it. That's genuine salvation. That's total forgiveness. That's total conversion. And he tells us, I will cleanse you myself. I'm going to pour that clean water upon you, and you will be clean. No doubt about that. Conversion. But then he said, it's not all through yet. It's not all done yet. There is another thing. That's sanctification. That's the holiness of heart. And that's the purity of heart. He said, I'm going to do that to a new heart also. The word also means, I've done that. That's settled. I've saved you. That's settled. You are converted. That's settled. You have repented and you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and your life is new. That's settled. But he says also, don't go yet. Don't go yet. Come back for this. In your heart also, will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. Verse 25, salvation. Verse 26, sanctification. It says, I'm not through with you yet. Then it comes to verse 27, and I will put my spirit within you. Didn't Jesus say, after the people were saved, after he said, rejoice because your names are written in heaven, born again. After he prayed for them, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Didn't he say, after that sanctification, wait and tarry in Jerusalem, for ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. That's why verse 25, salvation. Verse 26, sanctification. Verse 27, the immersion in the Holy Ghost. The indwelling of the Holy Ghost, the baptism in the Holy Ghost. I will put my spirit within you, and ye shall, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them. It says, I give you those three Christian experiences, and then you are ready to fulfill the totality, the entirety of all my will. And then it says, even though I give the promise, it's not automatic. You still must pray. Look at verse 37. Thus says the Lord God, I will yet for this be inquired of by the house of Israel to do it for them. I will yet for this be inquired of. You will seek my face. You will pray unto me. And you will make your request before me. And then I will give you what I promised. And I will increase them like what men like a flock. We're coming to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, and I'm reading from verse 33. Matthew chapter 6, we're looking at verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. I'm reading that again, but seek ye first, seek ye first. Let this be number one in your heart. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then it says, after that, all these things shall be added unto you. This year is a year of addition and a year of multiplication. And the blessings of God will be enriching your life this year in Jesus' name. Particularly, I'm looking at this, verse 33. And I title the message today, Rediscovering the Forgotten Path to Blessing. Rediscovering the Forgotten Path to Blessing. Many people pray, especially at the end of an old year and beginning of a new year, Lord, bless me. Lord, bless me. Lord, bless me. And then we list a lot of things that we want the Lord to do, and we have forgotten the path to blessing. And yet Jesus Christ reveals to us in one single sentence, as it is revealed in the totality of Scripture, from the Old Testament to the New Testament, how we get into the blessings of the Lord. The forgotten path to blessing. We want to rediscover that. What's that? Look at it in verse 33 again. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. There are three things we're looking at here. Number one, prioritizing the reign of the Most High King. Prioritizing, make it a priority. Seek ye first. Prioritizing the reign of the Most High King. Higher than the earth, higher than all the people of the earth, higher than angels, higher than all men, higher than everything you can think about, the Most High King, the Most High God. You prioritize the reign of that King. Point number one, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Prioritize the reign of the Most High King. Number two, pursuing the righteousness of his heavenly kingdom. Pursuing the righteousness of his heavenly kingdom, that you find in verse 30, right? Seek ye first and then his righteousness, the righteousness of God, the righteousness of his kingdom. Seek that righteousness. Number three, possessing the riches of his holy kingdom. Possessing the riches of his holy kingdom. What's that? Look at verse 33 again. And all these things shall be added unto you. The things to be added, the riches, the resources, material things, physical things, natural things, spiritual things to you, everything you desire, all that will be added once, number one, you pursue his reign. Number two, you prioritize his reign. Number two, you pursue his righteousness. And then number three, you'll possess the riches. Let's come to number one, prioritizing the reign of the Most High King. Prioritizing the reign of the Most High King. We're coming to Matthew chapter 6, the first part of verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Remember, we're talking about the forgotten path to blessing. Other people have realized this before, but many people don't realize this today, that if we're going to have all those things our hearts desire, there is one way to do that. After seed, you don't even think about those things. You want this, you want this, you want that, and you desire this, and you want to grab this, you want to have that. After seed, those things are not even on your mind. And say, number one, the priority, seek ye first the kingdom of God. As if all those other things do not matter, and they do not count to you. We're looking at 2 Chronicles chapter 1. In 2 Chronicles chapter 1, we're reading it from verse 7. In verse 7 it says, in that night did God appear to Solomon and said unto him, ask what I shall give thee. What if you were? The person that God said, ask what I will give you. If you do not know the path to blessing, if you think that, oh, I need this, I need this, I need that, you begin to bring a list before the Lord and see, and Solomon said unto God, thou hast showed great mercy unto David my father, and hast made me to reign in his stead, instead of him, in place of him, after him. Now, O Lord God, let thy promise unto David my father be established, for thou hast made me king over a people like the dust of the earth, a multitude. Give me now wisdom and knowledge, that I may go out and come in before these people. For who can judge? For who can lead? For who can direct? For who can teach? For who can portray? For who can be before these people, this great, this thy people that is so great? And God said to Solomon, because, underline that word in your Bible, because, mark that your Bible, because this was in thine heart, and thou hast not asked riches. Look at that. You have not asked riches, which the ordinary person will ask for, which the ordinary king will ask for, which the ordinary politician will ask for, which the ordinary professional man will ask for, which the ordinary church goer will ask for, which the ordinary Pentecostal Christian will ask for, which the ordinary person that goes to night vigil, which they will ask for. It says, because this was in thine heart, and thou hast not asked riches, wealth, honor, not life, not the life of thine enemies, neither yet hast thou asked for long life, but as wisdom and knowledge for thyself, that thou mayest judge my people. You put my people, my kingdom first. You keep my glory first, and you keep my joy first. It says, over whom I have made thee king, wisdom and knowledge is granted unto thee, and I will give thee riches which you didn't ask for, and wealth which you didn't ask for, and honor which you didn't ask for, such as none of the kings have had, that have been before thee, neither shall there be any after thee, like the light. You will see what the Lord is saying here. He says, because you are asking for my glory, and you are asking to fulfill the portion I've given you, that you reign over my people in a proper way, in a perfect way, in a good way that will satisfy me. Because you put me first, all these other things I will give you. You prioritize the kingdom of God and the glory of God and the righteousness of God. You are to see marriage. Well, God will do that, but that's not the important thing now. Job. God will do that. That's not the important thing now. Success, that's not the important thing now. The kingdom of God, you're born again. Because except a man be born again, he cannot see, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. You see, this is the number one thing, my relationship with God. This is the number one thing, my submission to God. This is the number one thing, my life in Christ. And you put that first. And let's look at those who do not do that and they feel, you know, this is what I want. Riches, that's what I'm going to put forth. That's what I'm going to have. If I don't have that, I can't be talking about salvation. Paul being born again and being cleansed when I'm hungry, when I need food, when I need clothing, when I need this or that. How can you be seeking of salvation? How can you be thinking of the kingdom of God? How can you be thinking of putting the glory of God first, the righteousness of God first, and the beauty of holiness? How can you be thinking of putting that first when here I don't have this, I don't have this? The foolishness of a man and the foolishness of a woman that forgets God and things is going to concentrate on personal things and physical things before the glory of God. But if you're wise, it's telling you to put God first. I'm telling you that what's important is who you are with God. And then you say, God is kingdom, is glory, is power, and his requirement. That's what I'm going to put forth. And it's when you do that in your life, all the other things will follow. Look at Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. I'm reading from verse 15. Luke chapter 12. We're reading from verse 15. It says in verse 15, and he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness. Take heed and beware. I want this, you've got it, I'm not satisfied. I want this again, you're not satisfied. I want this again. Take heed and beware of covetousness. For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesses. And he spake a parable unto them, saying, he's talking about a foolish man now, a man that will not put God first, a man that will not prioritize the kingdom of God, a man that will not make God his desire, and God his priority, and heaven his priority, and the glory of God his priority, a man that will not think of the kingdom of God first, a man that will say, clothing is first, education is first, profession is first, work is first, this other one is first, and then salvation will come after, and then God will come after, and then the glory of God will come after. What a foolish man, what a foolish woman that will be. And he spake a parable in verse 16 unto them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully, and he thought within himself, saying,